Today I want to discuss two questions. Why is rural sociology distinct from sociology? And what exactly is rural to begin with? Let's start with the first one. Rural sociology in the United States has its roots in the land-grant university system. In the Morrill Act of 1862, President Abraham Lincoln granted federal lands to universities as an endowment to study and teach applied sciences such as agriculture and engineering. These land grants built the foundation of today's agricultural colleges, such as Penn State. The land grant system was directed to develop and modernize rural places, people, and industries as part of a national modernization plan. It is out of this concern that rural sociology developed. From the beginning, rural sociology had this applied concern for development, but there was also a strand in the discipline that warned that too much modernization or modernization of the wrong kind would have devastating consequences for rural people. In contrast, mainstream sociology was mostly housed in liberal arts colleges and concerned with the living condition of the urban working class. But there was also overlap between rural sociology and sociology. First, until 1937, rural sociologists were members of the American Sociological Society, alongside all other sociologists. Second, the founding fathers of sociology, such as Emile Durkheim and Karl Marx, all shared an interest in rural and urban places and what connects the two. The overarching interest was, how did society change as people migrated from the countryside to the city for work? Interestingly, many sociologists saw this process as inevitable, but wanted it to create good living conditions for all, at least for white male workers. These early sociologists did not have a strong interest in the needs and desires of women and people of color. The break between sociology and rural sociology became more pronounced in the mid-20th century. Not only did rural sociology break out to become a separate academic society, the interest and perspective changed too. In Linda Lobao's text that I assigned you, she points out that for sociology, the rural became a remnant category, an underdeveloped place that would soon be folded into the modern, urban, industrialized world that was thus uninteresting as a subject of study. This view turned rural sociology into what Lobao called a sociology of geographic periphery, or what we might call as a sociology of the margins. Rural sociologists don't necessarily have a problem with that. Not only were many of them more sympathetic of rural people, they also continue to trace the relationships between rural and urban spaces in more dynamic ways as sociologists did. And I believe that this characterization still holds. But it's also important not to overstate the difference. Many rural sociologists are also members of the American Sociological Society, and outside of the land-grant universities, rural sociologists often work in liberal arts sociology departments. This is certainly true internationally, where most countries didn't create a separate institutional base in universities for rural sociology. I want to close the discussion about rural sociology by highlighting some of the topical interests and methods that distinguish the discipline. The most distinct field of interest is the sociology of food and agriculture. This is a topic you won't find in the American Sociological Association, and rarely as a field of specialization in a liberal arts sociology program. Another important subfield is the sociology of natural resources. Although mainstream sociology does have a tradition in environmental sociology, rural sociology has a strong emphasis on the extraction and use of natural resources. The third feature that characterizes rural sociology is its applied focus that often is related to questions of development, both domestically and internationally. Rural sociologists are often called in when development projects don't seem to work and economists want to understand why rural people don't behave the way they are supposed to in classical economic theory. Rural sociologists also often collaborate in interdisciplinary teams with agronomists, natural scientists, or civil engineers. As for other areas, rural sociologists often work on subjects that sociologists also work on, but focus specifically on its rural dimensions, such as rural poverty, rural health, rural demography, rural youth, rural communities, etc. A methodological specialty of rural sociology is its focus on speciality, that often brings it closer to geography than sociology. Rural sociologists have a strong sense that space matters and use spatial analytical tools much more commonly than their counterparts in sociology. As we have seen, whether rural spaces warrant their own study and theorization, or if they are an obsolete category, is a question that rural sociology has faced since its inception. That is a salient today where more than 50% of the world and 80% of the US population are considered urban. To answer this question, let's look at what characterizes rural places and what makes them a worthy subject of study. The first chapter in Brown and Schaft's book talks about this question. It is important to note that there is nothing natural about the rural-urban distinction. People make that distinction based on some characteristic they find important, and this can vary considerably. That's not necessarily a problem, but forces us to specify what we mean when we say rural. Brown and Schaff distinguish two ways of defining rural: a locational or place-based approach and a social constructivist approach. The locational approach defines rural as a physical place with distinct characteristics. Often the distinguishing features is demographics, for example, a population density below a certain threshold, or economic, such as a certain percentage of the population of an area that is employed in agriculture, forestry, mining, or some other land-based livelihood. Such a characterization is very precise because it is measurable in numbers. It is thus commonly used in policy making and program development, when federal or state funds are to be transferred to rural areas. It is also critical for rural demography as a quantitative, that is, number-based science. A challenge here is where to set the threshold between rural and urban. As you can easily understand, a threshold of 200 people per square mile would classify many more places as rural than a threshold of 1,000 people per square mile. This is highly political, because if this threshold is set higher, more places would qualify for funds for rural development, but leave less funds for any single community. Another problem with such a dichotomous distinction is that it draws a clear line between two conditions that are more appropriately thought of as a continuum. It is unreasonable to assume that a place with, say, 1,000 people per square mile is considerably different than a place with 999 people per square mile, which, by the way, is the official threshold for an urban census block per Census Bureau definition. But a place with 999 people and one with 10 people per square mile are supposed to be in the same category, although they are presumably very different. Technically speaking, it is often urban places that are defined, with rural places making up the residual of everything not considered rural. In fact, that's the approach that the US Census Bureau takes. If you want to find out how the Census Bureau defines rural, check out the story map linked in the comments. Now let's turn to the social constructivist approach of defining rural places. Social constructivism emphasizes that the images that we use to represent the world in our minds are shaped by the interaction that we have with others. This approach doesn't look at objective markers of rurality, but rather at the often ambiguous meanings that people associate with certain places. For example, if you move from Philadelphia to State College, you might think of State College as rural because there are pastures, forests, and Mount Nittany. If you come from Snowshoe, however, you might think of State College as urban because of the high-rise buildings, the parking garages, and coffee shops. The USDA Economic Research Service formally defines State College as metropolitan, but that doesn't stop people from assigning it different meanings or interpretations. You might say that such social constructivist definitions are wishy-washy and therefore don't have a place in rural studies and policy. Well, people in fact base important life decisions on their ideas of what is rural and what is not, such as the decision about where to retire. Real estate developers know that there is a market value associated with these sentiments when they call a new subdivision Westside Village or Orchard Park, despite these places lacking both village life and an orchard. Conservationists know this too. One popular way of mobilizing people to protect certain natural areas has always been to paint these areas as particular rural, sometimes quite literally painting or photographing or describing in novels. Last but not least, certain pictures of rurality are often drawn for political gain. In many countries, including the United States, rural places are often thought of as being more authentic and virtuous, a carrier of the soul of the nation. In social constructivist terms, there isn't really much substance to a nation beyond what people think of it, but this narrative helps to mobilize people to vote for populist candidates or to support the idea of a nation-state. This is what Brown and Schaft, citing Logan, describe as the rural mystic. On the flip side, many progressive leaders and media turn rural places into a regressive scapegoat to construct their own moral superiority. As wishy-washy such associations may be, they are effective in orienting people's action, and therefore they are important categories for rural sociology. In summary, it seems like there are features that make it possible to define and identify rural places even today, over 150 years later after the first sociologists predicted that urban society would eventually replace the rural world. But do these differences justify a separate sociological discipline? What do you think? This brings us to the question of the week. What were the reasons that motivated you to enroll in introductory rural sociology instead of sociology? Again, pause this video as you think through your response. I'll ask you this question again in the weekly assignment, but feel free to comment here on YouTube as well. And that sums it up for today. Thanks for watching and looking forward to discuss the meaning of rurality and the purpose of rural sociology next week. I hope you get out for a little bit, skip town, and enjoy whatever is rural about Center County. Enjoy your weekend.